The Works of President Jonathan Edwards, Volume 1, Chapter 4. His dismission from Northampton, with the occasion and circumstances of it. Whatever belongs to man, or more correctly, whatever is properly his own, bears the mark of mutability. Mr. Edwards' labors at Northampton were crowned at different periods of his ministry there with eminent success. But a root of bitterness sprung up, and many were defiled. The transactions contained in this chapter, though unpleasant, may afford, to a serious and reflecting mind, much instruction. If that people were more depraved than Christian churches in common, after enjoying so long a period the stated instructions and prayers of so eminent a pastor, how great the depravity of human nature to be capable of such ingratitude and such a reverse. Thus it was with Ephraim of old, when I would, saith God, have healed Israel, then the iniquity of Ephraim was discovered, and the wickedness, or the evils, of Samaria. But if the people in question were no more depraved than ourselves, let us learn caution and beware of unreasonable and inordinate attachment to customs. Let us contemplate with proper emotions the instability of all human affairs, the folly and danger of trusting in man, and remember that we depend on God for the preservation of the closest friendships, and that the best ministers, without the continued supply of the Holy Spirit on the minds of the people, have no sure interest in their affections, people to whom they have been most useful, and who were long most attached to them. Human nature has occasionally shown itself in every age to be the same, after the most extraordinary manifestation of divine power and goodness. The whole congregation of the children of Israel murmured against Moses and Aaron in the wilderness, and after the most awful and impressive instructions, the Lord had to say to Moses, Go, get thee down, for thy people, which thou broughtest out of the land of Egypt, have corrected themselves. For many years Mr. Edwards was very happy in the love and esteem of his people, and there were, during that period, the greatest prospect of his living and dying so. Indeed, he was almost the last minister in all New England that would have been thought likely to be opposed by his people. But the event proved how incompetent we are to decipher those consequences which depend on human volition. In the year 1744, about 6 years before the final rupture, Mr. Edwards was informed that some young persons in the town who were members of the church had books in their possessions which they employed to promote lascivious and obscene discourse among the young people. Upon inquiry, a number of the persons testified that they had heard one and another, from time to time, talk obscenely, as what they were led to by reading a book or two, or books which they had among them. Mr. Edwards thought the brethren of the church ought to look into the matter, and in order to introduce it, he preached a sermon from Hebrews chapter 12, verse 15 and 16. Look diligently, lest any man fail of the grace of God, lest any root of bitterness springing up trouble you, and thereby many be defiled, lest there be any fornicator or profane person as Esau, etc. After sermon, he desired the brethren of the church to stay, and told them what information he had got, and proposed whether they thought proper to take any measures to examine into the matter. They, with one consent and much zeal, manifested it to be their opinion that it ought to be inquired into, and proceeded to choose a number of men to assist their pastor in examining into the affair, upon which Mr. Edwards appointed the time for their meeting at his house, and then read a catalogue of the names of the young persons whom he desired to come to his house at the same time. Some were the accused, and some witnesses. But it was not then declared of which number any particular person was. When the names were published, it appeared that there were but few of the considerable families in the town to which some of the persons named did not belong, or were nearly related. Whether this was the occasion of the alteration or not, before the day appointed came, however, a great number of heads of families altered their minds and declared that they did not think proper to proceed as they had done, that their children should not be called into account in such a way, etc. The town was suddenly all in a blaze. This strengthened the hands of the accused. Some refused to appear, and others who did appear behaved with a great degree of insolence and contempt of the authority of the church, and little or nothing could be done further in the affair. This was the occasion of weakening Mr. Edwards' hands in the work of the ministry, especially among the young people, with whom, by this means, he greatly lost his influence. It doubtless laid a foundation, and will help to account for the surprising events which will be related. He certainly had no great visible success after this. The influences of God's Holy Spirit were greatly withheld, and security and carnality much increased. Mr. Stoddard, Mr. Edwards' grandfather and predecessor, was of the opinion that unconverted persons, considered as such, had a right in the sight of God, or by his appointment, to the sacrament of the Lord's Supper, that therefore it was their duty to come to that ordinance, though they knew they had no true goodness or gospel holiness. He maintained that visible Christianity does not consist in a profession or appearance of that wherein true holiness or real Christianity consists, that therefore the profession which persons make in order to be received as visible members of Christ's church ought not to be such as to express or imply a real compliancy with or consent to the terms of the covenant of grace or a hearty embracing of the gospel. He formed a sure profession for persons to make in order to be admitted into the church answerable to this principle, and accordingly persons were admitted into the church and to the sacrament on those terms. Mr. Stoddard's principle at first made a great noise in the country. He was opposed as introducing something contrary to the principles and practices of almost all the churches in New England, and the matter was publicly controverted between him and the Dr. Increase Mather of Boston. However, through Mr. Stoddard's great influence over the people at Northampton, it was introduced there, though not without opposition. By degrees it spread over much of the ministers and people in that county and in other parts of New England. Mr. Edwards had some hesitation about this matter when he first settled at Northampton, but did not receive such a degree of conviction as to prevent his adopting it with a good conscience for some years. But at length his doubts increased, which put him upon examining it thoroughly by searching the Scripture and reading such books as were written on the subject. The result was a full conviction that it was wrong, and that he could not retain the practice with a good conscience. He was fully convinced that to be a visible Christian was to put on the visibility or appearance of a real Christian, that the profession of Christianity was a profession on that wherein real Christianity consists, and therefore that no person who rejected Christ in his heart could make such a profession consistent with truth. And as the ordinancy of the Lord's Supper was instituted for none but visible professing Christians, none but those who are real Christians have a right in the sight of God to come to that ordinancy, and consequently that none ought to be admitted thereto who do not make a profession of real Christianity, and so be received in a judgment of charity as true friends to Jesus Christ. When Mr. Edwards' sentiments were known, in the spring of the year 1744, it gave great offense, and the town was put into a great ferment, and therefore he was heard in his own defense, or it was known by many what his principles were. The general cry was to have him dismissed as what alone would satisfy them. That was evident from the whole tenure of their conduct, as they neglected the most proper means of understanding the matter in dispute, and persisted in a refusal to attend to what Mr. Edwards had to say in defense of his principles. From beginning to end, they opposed the measures which had the best tendency to compromise and heal the difficulty, and with much zeal pursued those which were calculated to make a separation certain and speedy. He thought of preaching on the subject, that they might know what were his sentiments, and the grounds of them, of both which he was sensible that most of them were quite ignorant, before they took any step for a separation. But that he might do nothing to increase the turmoil, he first proposed the thing to the church's standing committee, supposing that if he entered on the subject publicly with their consent, it would prevent the ill consequences which otherwise he feared would follow. But the most of them strenuously opposed it, upon which he gave it over for the present, as what in such circumstances would rather blow up the fire to a greater height than answer the good means proposed. Mr. Edwards was sensible that his principles were not understood, but misrepresented to the country, and finding that his people were then to warn calmly to attend to the matter in controversy, he proposed to print what he had to say on the point, as this seemed to be the only way left him to have a fair hearing. Accordingly, his people consented to put off calling a council till what he should write was published. But they manifested great uneasiness in waiting before it came out of the press, and when it was published, it was read, but by very few of them. Mr. Edwards, being sensible of this, renewed his proposal to preach upon it, and at a meeting of the brethren of the church, asked their consent in the following terms. I desire that the brethren would manifest their consent, and I should declare the reasons of my opinion relating to full communion in the church in lecture times appointed for that end, not as an act of authority or as putting the power of declaring the whole counsel of God out of my hands, but for peace's sake to prevent occasion of strife. This was answered in the negative. He then proposed that it should be left to a few of the neighboring ministers, whether it was not, all things considered, reasonable that he should be heard in this matter from the pulpit before the affair should be brought to an issue. But this also passed in the negative. However, having had the advice of the ministers and messengers of the neighboring churches, who met at Northampton to advise them under their difficulties, he proceeded to appoint a lecture in order to preach on the subject, proposing to do so weekly till he finished what he had to say. On Monday there was a society meeting in which a vote was passed to choose a committee to go to Mr. Edwards and desire him not to preach lectures on the subject in controversy according to his declaration and appointment. Accordingly, a committee of three men chosen for this purpose waited on him. However, Mr. Edwards thought proper to proceed according to his proposal and consequently preached a number of sermons till he had finished what he had to say on the subject. These lectures were very thinly attended by his own people, but great numbers of strangers from the neighboring towns attended them, so many as to make above half the congregation. This was in February and March, 1750. The calling of a decisive council to determine the matter of differency was now more particularly attended to on both sides. Mr. Edwards had before this insisted, from time to time, that they were by no means ripe for such a procedure, as they had not yet given him a fair hearing, whereby perhaps the need of such a council would be superseded. He observed that it was exceedingly unbecoming to manage religious affairs of the greatest importance in a ferment and turmoil, which ought to be managed with great solemnity, deep humiliation, submission to the awful frowns of heaven, humble dependency on God, with fervent prayer and supplication to him. That therefore for them to go about such an affair as they did would be greatly to dishonor of God and religion, a way in which the people cannot expect a blessing. Thus having, without effect, used all means to bring them to a calm and charitable temper, he consented that a decisive council should be called without any further delay. But a difficulty attended the choice of a council, which was for some time insuperable. It was agreed that the council should be mutually chosen, one half by the pastor and the other half by the church. But the people insisted upon it that he should be confined in his choice to the county. Mr. Edwards thought this an unreasonable restraint, as it was known that the ministers and churches in that county were almost universally against him in the controversy. He indeed did not suppose that the business of the proposed council would be to determine whether his opinion was right or not, but whether any possible way could be devised for an accommodation between the pastor and the people, and to use their wisdom and endeavor to order to effect it. And if they found this impracticable, they must determine whether what ought in justice to be done had already actually been attempted, so that there was nothing further to be demanded by either of the parties concerned before a separation should take place. And if he was dismissed by them, it would be their business to set forth in the world in what manner and for what cause he was dismissed, all which were masters of great importance to him, and required upright and impartial judges. Now, considering the great prejudice a difference in religious opinions is apt to beget, the close connection of the point in which most of the ministers and churches in the county differ from him, with the matter to be decided, he did not think they could be reasonably looked upon so impartial judges as that the matter ought to be wholly left to them. Besides, he thought the case, being so new and extraordinary, required the ablest judges in the land. For these reasons, and some others which he offered, he insisted upon liberty to go out of the county for those members of the proposed council in which he was to have a choice. The people, strenuously and obstinately opposing him in this, at length agreed to leave the matter to a council, consisting of ministers and messengers of the five neighboring churches, who, after they had met twice upon it, and had the case largely debated before them, were equally divided, and therefore left the matter undetermined. However, they were all agreed that Mr. Edwards ought to have the liberty to go out of the county for some of the council. And at the next church meeting, the 26th of March, Mr. Edwards offered to join with them in calling a council if they would consent that he should choose two of the churches out of the county in case the council consisted of but 10 churches. The church, however, refused to comply with this at one meeting after another repeatedly, and proceeded to call a church meeting and chose a moderator in order to act without the pastor. But to pass by many particulars at length, at a meeting of the church convened by their pastor, May 3rd, they voted their consent to his proposal of going out of the county for two of the churches that should be applied to. And then they proceeded to make choice of 10 ministers and churches of which the council should consist. Accordingly, the churches were applied to, and the council was convened on the 19th of June. After they had made some fruitless attempts for a composition between the pastor and church, they passed a resolution by a majority of one voice. Footnote: one of the churches which Mr. Edwards chose did not see fit to join the council. However, the minister of the church, being at Northampton, was desired by Mr. Edwards and the church to sit in council and act, which he did. But there being no messenger from the church, the council was not full, and there was a disparity, by which means there was one vote more for an immediate dismissal than against it. End of the footnote. Only to the following purpose: that it is expedient that the pastoral relation between Mr. Edwards and his church be immediately dissolved, if the people still persist in desiring it, and it being publicly put to the people whether they still insisted on Mr. Edwards' dismission from the pastoral office over them. A great majority, above 200 against 20, voted for his dismissal, and he was accordingly dismissed, June 22, 1750. The dissenting part of the council ended their protest against this proceeding, judging that it was too much in a hurry considering the past conduct and present temper of the people, and some of that part of the council, who were for the separation, expressed themselves surprised at the uncommon zeal manifested by the people in their voting for a dismissal, which evidenced to them and all observing spectators that they were far from a temper of mind, being such a solemn and awful transaction, considered in all its circumstances. Being thus dismissed, he preached his farewell sermon on the 1st of July from 2 Corinthians 1:14. The doctrine he observed from the words was this: ministers and the people that have been under their care must meet one another before Christ's tribunal at the day of judgment. It was a remarkably solemn and affecting discourse, and was published at the desire of some of the hearers. And Mr. Edwards was dismissed from Northampton. He preached there occasionally when they had no other preacher to supply the pulpit, till at length a great uneasiness was manifested by many of the people at his preaching there at all, upon which the committee for supplying the pulpit called the town together to know their minds with respect to that matter, when they voted that it was not agreeable to their minds that it should preach among them. Accordingly, while Mr. Edwards was in the town, and they had no other minister to preach to them, they carried on public worship among themselves. Everyone must be sensible that this was a great trial to Mr. Edwards. He had been nearly 24 years among that people, and his labors had been, to all appearance, from time to time greatly blessed among them. And a great number looked on him as their spiritual father, who had been the happy instrument of turning them from darkness to light, and plucking them as bands out of the burning. And they had, from time to time, professed that they looked upon it as one of the greatest privileges to have such a minister, and manifested their great love and esteem of him, to such a degree that, as St. Paul says of the Galatians, if it had been possible, they would have plucked out their own eyes and given them to him. And they had a great interest in his affection. He had borne them on his heart, and carried them in his bosom for many years, exercising a tender concern and love for them. For their good he was always writing, contriving, laboring. For them he had poured out 10,000 fervent prayers. In their good he had rejoiced as one that findeth great spoil. and they were dear to him above all other people under heaven. Now to have those people turn against him and thrust him out from among them, stopping their ears and running upon him with furious zeal, not allowing him to defend himself by giving him a fair hearing, and even refusing so much as to hear him preach, many of them surmising and publicly speaking many ill things as to his ends and designs. Surely this must come very near to him and try his spirit. The words of the psalmist seems applicable to this case. It was not an enemy that reproached me, then I could have borne it. Neither was it he that hated me that did magnify himself against me, then I would have hid myself from him. But it was thou, my guide and my acquaintance. We took sweet counsel together and walked into the house of God in company. Let us therefore now behold the man, the calm sedateness of his mind, his meekness and humility in great and violent opposition and injurious treatment, his resolution and steady conduct through all this dark and terrible storm, were truly wonderful and cannot be set in so beautiful and affecting a light by any description as they appeared in to his friends who were eyewitnesses. Mr. Edwards had a numerous and chargeable family with little or no income, exclusive of his salary, and with considering how far he was advanced in years, the general disposition of the people who want a minister to prefer a young man who has never been settled to one who had been dismissed from his people, and what misrepresentation were made of his principles throughout the country. It looked to him not at all probable that he should ever have opportunity to be settled again in the work of the ministry if he was dismissed from Northampton, and he was not inclined or able to take any other course or go into any other business to get a living. So that beggary, as well as disgrace, stared him full in the face if he persisted in his principles. When he was fixed in his principles, and before they were publicly known, he told some of his friends that if he discovered and persisted in them, it would most likely issue in his dismissal and disgrace, and the ruin of himself and his family as to their temporal interests. He therefore first sat down and counted the cost, and deliberately took up the cross when it was set before him in its full weight and magnitude, and in direct opposition to all worldly views and motives, and therefore his conduct in these circumstances was a remarkable exercise in discovery of his own consciousness, and his readiness to deny himself and forsake all that he had to follow Christ. A man must have a considerable degree of the spirit of a martyr to go on with the steadfastness and resolution with which he did. He ventured with wherever truth and duty appeared to lead him, unmoved at the threatening dangers on every side. However, God did not forsake him, as he gave him those inward supports by which he was able to pay in patience to possess the soul and courageously row on in the storm, in the face of boisterous winds beating hard upon him, and in the midst of gaping waves threatening to swallow him up. So he soon appeared for him in his providency, even beyond all his expectations. His correspondencies and other friends in Scotland, hearing of his dismissal and fearing it might be the means of bringing him into worldly straits, generously contributed a considerable sum and sent it over to him. And God did not leave him without tender, valuable friends in Northampton, for a small number of his people who opposed his dismissal from the beginning, and some who acted on either side, but after his dismissal, adhered to him, under the influence of the great esteem and love of Mr. Edwards, were willing and thought themselves able to maintain him, and insisted upon it that it was his duty to stay among them, as a distinct and separate congregation from the body of the town who had rejected him. Mr. Edwards could not see it to be his duty to stay among them, as this would probably be a means of perpetuating an unhappy division in the town, and there was to him no prospect of doing the good there, which would counterbalance the evil. However, that he might do all he could to satisfy his tender and afflicted friends, he consented to ask the advice of an ecclesiastic council. Accordingly, a council was called and met at Northampton on the 15th of May, 1751. The town on this occasion was put into a great turmoil. They who were active in Mr. Edwards' dismissal supposed, though without any good grounds, that he was contriving with his friends again to introduce himself at Northampton. They drew up a remonstration against their proceeding and laid it before the council, though they would not acknowledge them to be an ecclesiastic council. containing many heavy, though groundless, insinuations and charges against Mr. Edwards, and bitter accusations of the party who had adhered to him, but refused to appear and support any of their charges, or so much as to give the gentlemen of the council any opportunity to confer with them about the affair depending, though it was diligently sought. The council, having heard what Mr. Edwards and they who adhered to him had to say, advised agreeably to Mr. Edwards' judgment that he should leave Northampton and accept the mission to which he was invited at Stockbridge, of which a more particular account will be given. Many of the facts relative to this sorrowful and surprising affair, the most so doubtless of any kind that ever happened in North New England, and perhaps in any part of the Christian world, might be related. But as this more general history of it may be suffice to answer the ends proposed, viz., to rectify some gross misrepresentations that have been made of the matter and discover the great trial Mr. Edwards had herein, it is thought best to suppress other particulars as a proper close melancholy story, and to confirm and further illustrate what has been related, the following letter from Joseph Howley, Esquire, a gentleman who was very active in the transactions of this whole affair, and very much a leader in it, to the Reverend Mr. Hall of Sutton, published in a weekly newspaper in Boston, May 19, 1760, is here inserted. To the Reverend Mr. Hall of Sutton, Northampton, May 9, 1760. Reverend Sir, I have often wished that every member of the two ecclesiastical councils that formerly sat in Northampton upon the unhappy differences between our former most worthy and reverend pastor, Mr. Jonathan Edwards, and the church here, whereof you were a member. I say, sir, I have often wished every one of them truly knew my real sense of my own conduct in the affairs that the one and the other of the said councils are privy to, as I have long apprehended it to be my duty not only to humble myself before God for what was unchristian and sinful in my conduct before the said councils, but also to confess my faults to them and take shame to myself before them. So I have often studied with myself in what manner it was practicable for me to do it. When I understood that you, sir, and Mr. Eden were to be at Cold Spring at the time of the late council, I resolved to improve the opportunity fully to open my mind there to you and him thereon, and thought that probably some method might be then thought of in which my reflections on myself, touching the matters above hinted at, might be communicated to most, if not all, the gentlemen aforesaid who did not reside in this county. But you know, sir, how difficult it was for us to converse together by ourselves when at Cold Spring, without giving umbrage to that people. I therefore propose writing to you upon the matters which I had then opportunity only most summarily to suggest, which you, sir, signified would be agreeable to you. I therefore now undertake what I then proposed, in which I humbly ask the divine aid, that I may be made most freely willing fully to confess my sin and guilt to you and the world in those instances which I have reason to suppose fell under your notice, as they were public and notorious transactions, and on account whereof, therefore, you, sir, and all others who had knowledge thereof had just cause to be offended at me. And in the first place, sir, I apprehended that, with the church and the people of Northampton, I sinned and erred exceedingly in consenting and laboring that there should be so early a dismissal that Mr. Edwards, from his pastoral relations to us, even upon the supposition that he was really in a mistake in the disputed point, not only because the dispute was upon matters so very disputable in themselves and at the greatest removal from fundamental, but because Mr. Edwards so long had approved himself a most faithful and painful pastor to the said church. He also changed his sentiments in that point, wholly from a tender regard to what appeared to him to be truth, and had made known his sentiments with great moderation and upon great deliberation against all worldly motives, from mere fidelity to his great master and a tender regard to the souls of his flock, as we had the highest reason to judge. These considerations now seem to me sufficient, and would, if we had been of a right spirit, have greatly endeared him to his people, and made us to the last degree reluctant to part with him, and disposed us to the exercise of the greatest candor, gentleness, and moderation. How much of the reverse whereof appeared in us, I need not tell you, sir, who were an eyewitness of our temper and conduct. And although it does not become me to pronounce decisively on a point so disputable as what was then in dispute, yet I beg leave to say that I really apprehended that it is of the highest moment in the body of this church, and to me in particular, most solicitously to inquire whether, like the Pharisees and lawyers in John the Baptist's time, we did not reject the counsel of God against ourselves in rejecting Mr. Edwards and his doctrine, which was the ground of his dismissal. And I humbly conceive that it highly imports us all of this church most seriously and impartially to examine what that most worthy and able divine published about that time in support of the same, whereby he, being dead, yet speaketh. But there were three things, sir, especially in my own particular conduct before the first council, which have been justly matter of great grief and much trouble to me almost ever since, viz. In the first place, I confess, sir, that I acted very immodestly and abusively to you, as well as injuriously to the church and myself, when with much zeal and unbecoming assurance, I moved the council that they would impose to silence and stop you in an address you were making one morning to the people, wherein you were, if I do not forget, briefly exhorting them to a tender remembrance of the former affection and harmony that had long subsisted between them and their reverend pastor, and the great comfort and profit which they apprehended that they had received from his ministry, for which, sir, I hardly ask your forgiveness, and I think that we ought, instead of opposing an exhortation of that nature, to have received it with all thankfulness. Another particular of my conduct before that council, which I now apprehend was criminal and was owing to the want of that tender affection and reverent respect and esteem for Mr. Edwards, which he had highly merited of me, was my strenuously opposing the adjournment of the matters submitted to that council for about 2 months, for which I declare myself unfeigningly sorry, and I with shame remember that I did it in a peremptory, decisive, vehement, and very immodest manner. But, sir, the most criminal part of my conduct at that time that I am conscious of was my exhibiting to that council a set of arguments in writing, a drift whereof was to prove the reasonableness and necessity of Mr. Edwards' dismission, in case no accommodation was then effected with mutual consent, which writing by clear implication contained some severe, uncharitable, and, if I remember right, groundless and slanderous imputations on Mr. Edwards expressed in bitter language. And although the original draft thereof was not done by me, yet I foolishly and sinfully consented to copy it, and as agent for the church to read it and deliver it to the council, which I could never have done if I had not a wicked relish for perverse things, which conduct of mine I confess was very sinful and highly provoking to God, for which I am ashamed and confounded and have nothing to answer. As to the church remonstration, as it is called, which their committee preferred to the last of the said councils, to all which I was consenting, and in the composing whereof I was very active, as also in bringing the church to their vote upon it, I would in the first place only observe that I do not remember anything in that small part of it which was plainly expressive of the expedience of Mr. Edwards' resettlement here as pastor to a part of the church which was very exceptionable. But as to all the residue, which was much the greatest part thereof, and I am not certain that any part was wholly free, it was everywhere interlarded with unchristian bitterness, sarcastical and unmannerly insinuations. It contained divers, direct, grievous, and criminal charges and allegations against Mr. Edwards, which I have since good reason to suppose were all founded on jealousy and uncharitable mistakes, and so were really gross slanders. Also many heavy and reproachable charges upon divers of Mr. Edwards' adherents, and some severe censures of them all indiscriminately, all of which, if not wholly false and groundless, yet were altogether unnecessary, and therefore highly criminal. Indeed, I am fully convinced that the whole of the composure, excepting the small part thereof, above mentioned, was totally unchristian, a scandalous, abusive, injurious libel against Mr. Edwards and his particular friends, especially the former, and highly provoking and detestable in the sight of God, for which I am heartily sorry and ashamed, and pray I may remember it with deep abasement and penitence all my days. Nor do I now think that the Church's conduct in refusing to appear and attend before that council to support the charges and allegations and the said remonstration against Mr. Edwards and the said brethren, which they demanded, was ever vindicated by all the subtle answers that were given to the said demand. Nor do I think that our conduct in that instance was capable of defense, for it appears to me that by making such charges against them before the said council, we necessarily so far gave that council jurisdiction, and I own with sorrow and regret that I zealously endeavored that the Church should perseveringly refuse to appear before the said council for the purpose aforesaid, which I humbly pray God to forgive. Another part of my conduct, sir, of which I have long repented, and for which I hereby declare by hearty sorrow, with my obstinate opposition to the last council's having any conference with the Church, which the said council earnestly and repeatedly moved for, and which the Church, as you know, finally denied. I think it discovered a great deal of pride and vain sufficiency in the Church, and showed them to be very opinionated, especially the chief sticklers, one of whom I was, and think it was running a most presumptuous risk, and acting the part of proud scorners, for us to refuse hearing, and candidly and seriously considering, what that council could say or oppose to us, among whom there were divers, justly in great reputation for grace and wisdom. In these instances, sirs, of my conduct, and in others, to which you were not privy, in the course of the most melancholy contention with Mr. Edwards, I now see that I was very much influenced by vast pride, self-sufficiency, ambition, and vanity. I appear to myself vile, and doubtless much more so to others, who are more impartial, and do in the review thereof abhor myself and repent sorely. And if my own heart condemns me, it behooves me solemnly to remember that God is greater, and knoweth all things. I hereby own, sir, that such treatment of Mr. Edwards, wherein I was so deeply concerned and active, was particularly and very aggravatedly sinful and ungrateful in me, because I was not only under the common obligations of each individual of the society to him, as to a most able, diligent, and faithful pastor, but I had also received many instances of his tenderness, goodness, and generosity to me, as a young kinsman, whom he was disposed to treat in a most friendly manner. Indeed, sir, I must own that by my conduct in consulting and acting against Mr. Edwards within the time of our most unhappy disputes with him, and especially in and about that abominable remonstration, I have so far symbolized with Balaam and Judas that I am confounded and filled with terror oftentimes when I attend to the most painful solemnity. And I freely confess that on account of my conduct above mentioned, I have the greatest reason to tremble at those most solemn and awful words of our Savior, Matthew chapter 18, verse 6, "Whoso offended one of these," etc., and those in Luke 10:16, "He that despises you," etc. And I am most sorely sensible that nothing but that infinite grace and mercy would save some of the betrayers and murderers of our blessed Lord, and the persecutors of his martyrs can pardon me, in which alone I hope for pardon for the sake of Christ, whose blood, blessed be God, cleanses from all sin. On the whole, sir, I am convinced that I have the greatest reason to say as David, "Have mercy upon me, O God, according to thy loving kindness, according to the multitude of thy tender mercies, blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity, and cleanse me from my sin. For I acknowledge my transgressions, and my sin is ever before me. Hide thy face from my sins, and blot out all my iniquities. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from thy presence, and take not thy Holy Spirit from me." Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation, and uphold me with thy free spirit. Psalms 51, 1-3, 9-12. And I humbly apprehend that it greatly concerns the Church of Northampton most seriously to examine whether the many hard speeches spoken by many particular members against the former pastor, some of which the Church really countenanced, and especially those spoken by the Church as a body in that most vile remonstration, are not so odious and ungodly as to be utterly incapable of defense, whether the said Church were not guilty of a great sin in becoming so willing and disposed for so slight a cause to part with so faithful and godly a minister as Mr. Edwards was, and whether ever God will hold us guiltless till we cry to him for Christ's sake to pardon and save us from that judgment which such ungodly deeds deserve. And I most heartily wish and pray that the town and the Church of Northampton would seriously and carefully examine whether they have not abundant cause to judge that they are now lying under great guilt in the sight of God, and whether those of us who were concerned in that most awful contention with Mr. Edwards can ever more reasonably expect God's favor and blessing till our eyes are open and we become thoroughly convinced that we have greatly provoked the Most High and have been injurious to one of the best of men, and until we shall be thoroughly convinced that we have dreadfully persecuted Christ by persecuting and vexing that just man and servant of Christ, until we shall be humble as in the dust on account of it, until we openly in full terms and without bulking the matter confess the same before the world, and most humbly and earnestly seek forgiveness of God, and do what we can to honor the memory of Mr. Edwards and clear it of all the aspersions which we unjustly cast upon him, since God has been pleased to put it beyond our power to ask his forgiveness. Such terms, I am persuaded, the great and righteous God will hold us to, and that it will be in vain for us to hope to escape with impunity in any other way. This I am convinced of with regard to myself, and this way I most solemnly propose to take myself, if God in his mercy shall give me opportunity, that so by making free confession to God and man of my sin and guilt, and publicly taking shame to myself, I may give glory to God of Israel, and do what in me lies to clear the memory of that venerable man from the wrongs and injuries I was so active in bringing on his reputation and character. I thank God that he has been pleased to spare my life to this time, and am sorry that I have delayed the affair so long. Although I made the substance of almost all the foregoing reflections in writing, but not exactly in the same manner, to Mr. Edwards and the brethren who adhered to him in Mr. Edwards' life and before he removed from Stockbridge, and I have reason to believe that he, from his great candor and charity, heartily forgave me and prayed for me. Yet, because that was not generally known, I look on myself obliged to take further steps for which I kept silent. My bones waxed old, etc. For all these, my great sins, therefore, in the first place, I humbly and most earnestly ask forgiveness of God, in the next place of the relatives and near friends of Mr. Edwards. I also ask the forgiveness of all those who were called Mr. Edwards' adherents, and of all the members of the ecclesiastical councils above mentioned, and lastly, of all Christian people who have had any knowledge of these matters. I have no desire, sir, that you should make any secret of this letter, but that you would communicate the same to whom you shall judge proper. And I purpose, if God shall give me opportunity, to procure it to be published in some one of the public newspapers, for I cannot devise any other way of making known my sentiments of the foregoing matters to all who ought to be acquainted therewith. And therefore I think I ought to do it, whatever remarks I may foresee will be made thereon. Probably when it comes out, some of my acquaintance will pronounce me quite overrun with vapors. Others will be furnished with matter for mirth and pleasantry. Others will curiously pass it over as relating to matters quite stale. But some, I am persuaded, will rejoice to see me brought to a sense of my sin and duty. And I myself shall be conscious that I have done something of what the nature of the case admits, towards undoing what is, and long has been, to my greatest remorse and trouble that I have ever done. Sir, I desire that none would entertain a thought from my having spoken respectfully, Mr. Edwards, that I am disaffected to our present pastor, for the very reverse is true. And I have a reverent esteem, real value, and hearty affection for him, and bless God that he has, notwithstanding all our unworthiness, given us one to succeed, Mr. Edwards, who, as I have reason to hope, is truly faithful. I conclude this long letter by heartily desiring your prayers that my repentance of my sins of above mentioned may be unfinished and genuine, and such as God in infinite mercy for Christ's sake will accept, and I beg leave to subscribe myself, Sir, your real, though very unworthy friend and obedient servant, Joseph Hawley, H-A-W-L-E-Y. End of chapter 4, Heaven the Rev. By Peter John Parisis.